Hello, everybody. Welcome. My name is Jessa Barzilay, and I am the Director of Learning Engagement at San Francisco Botanical Garden. Very happy to be sharing space with you this evening. This presentation is being sponsored, presented by the Helen Crocker Russell Library, which we very much hope opens soon. And tonight we are with Christopher Pollock, San Francisco Recreation and Park Department's historian in residence. It's my absolute pleasure to be holding this community space tonight. I know we have some competing programming this evening, so I'm very happy that almost 100 of you are joining us this evening. As we wait for people to arrive, another minute or so, I'd like to share a brief look at the library's virtual exhibit. Hopefully you have already checked this out, but I wanted to show you one quick peek at it as we get started. Very much in the topic of today's presentation, for the 150th anniversary of Golden Gate Park, the library curated an art exhibit called From Sand Dunes to Forest, Canopy Trees of Golden Gate Park. You'll be able to find this on our website under the library's programs page. And this is a celebration of the story of the horticultural transformation of the park from the wild stretch of sand dunes that it was to the verdant parkland that we know today. And an amazing team of staff and volunteers helped put together this website. In an open submissions process, the work of over 30 artists were selected to portray the canopy trees, including the three main species, Monterey cypress, Monterey pine, and blue gum eucalyptus. Other signature trees of the park are included, like giant sequoia, coast redwood, coast live oak, and California buckeye. The artwork represents trees and landscapes as single or multiple trees, and the imagery includes various parts of a tree, such as branches, cones, seeds, flowers, and leaves, and even include some birds. Also included are historical images and texts that help tell the story of the creation of the park. You can find the exhibit on the San Francisco Botanical Garden website, again, but we'll also put the link in the chat box, and the link will also be posted at the end of this presentation as well. Before I introduce Christopher, I'd like to encourage you all to use the Q&A feature during the talk. We'll reserve time at the end of this hour to read out and answer as many questions as we can. Also, at the end of the presentation, we'll include information about where to purchase Christopher's book, and we can follow up with email on more information about that as well. There is a chance always that we won't get to all of your questions, and if that's the case, we will be able to address those over email after the fact as well. So with that, I'd like to invite Christopher to join us on the screen. Hi there.
Hi, everyone.
I'm really excited to welcome you to speak today about the new edition of your book and the fascinating history of Golden Gate Park. So here's a little bit more about Christopher. In 2016, Christopher was tapped by the Recreation and Park Department to be their first historian in residence for all the city's parks. With this, he brought a layer of history to the department. His initial project was to research and record the history of the department's some 225 holdings. With the 150th anniversary of Golden Gate Park this year, he launched the latest version of his book. This was preceded by another publication, Real San Francisco Stories, an annotated filmography of the Bay Area, published in 2013, which was about the some 650 movies filmed in the Bay Area. Christopher started his career as a designer specializing in interior architecture. With this experience, he changed gears to focus on historic preservation, specializing in historic research. A native of Connecticut, he has resided in San Francisco since 1979. Welcome, Christopher. Thank you for sharing your time and this space with us all tonight.
Thank you, Jessa. I'm really pleased to be here. Welcome to the virtual Lindley Meadow in Golden Gate Park, I'm going to tell you about my newly published book, San Francisco's Golden Gate Park, 1,017 Acres of Stories. And give me a moment to transition into the presentation, and then we'll get started. Okay. Golden Gate Park is one of my favorite places, and I wanted to let others in on what I have found after decades of in-depth research. With my research background in Golden Gate Park, Phil Ginsberg, general manager of the Recreation and Park Department, asked me to be the first historian in residence for all of the city's parks, a position which began in latter of 2016. As Jessa mentioned, my initial task was to write histories for all of the department's 230 holdings, which was quite a project and is actually still ongoing. So just as Golden Gate Park has gone through many significant changes and upgrades during the past 20 years, so goes this publication. And here's a photo of my original publication that was launched actually 19 years ago. And so with the promise of the 150th anniversary of Golden Gate Park in the future, I sought out a publisher to produce an updated book. And it turns out a local publisher, Norfolk Press, took up the task. So here's the cover of the book, and I'm going to go through initially and talk about some of the things that have, many things that have happened in the park and in the many years. But I'm going to give a little background about the 150th anniversary first. And that is that the birthday, if you will, of Golden Gate Park is April 4th, 1870. So 150 years ago this past April. And it was by the signature of Governor Haight on that date that gave us Golden Gate Park as an official entity. Up until that time, it really didn't have any name. This is the official map that that went along. It's an exhibit that went along with legislation that was created. And you'll notice that it just says park, where Golden Gate Park would be one day. So this is 1870. And notice all the streets in the districts that flank Golden Gate Park in both the Richmond and the Sunset. None of those were actually there. This was all a projected map of what things would look like in the future. And of course, it eventually was fleshed out. So I'm going to start off with some of the rebuilding that's taken place and within the park in the past 20 years. There have been many projects that have happened. There's also been many finds in the park in the past few years as well that were surprises, certainly to me. And so I'll go through a few of them. And certainly the rebuilding of the DeYoung Museum from its former tower itself. And I might point out on this slide where you're seeing the old museum on the top, and then in more recent times before it was demolished, a planar museum. A lot of people thought that in fact this was a modernization. During the 1930s, it was common for people to modernize their Victorian houses. Well, in fact, in this case, it had to do with the fact that all of the decorative application of pilasters and friezes and all of that were falling off the DeYoung Museum. And in fact, the stuccoing of the outside was in order to make it a more safe building. So the new DeYoung reopened, of course, in 2002. And across the way, across the music concourse is the California Academy of Sciences. Here's a card showing what that originally looked like as well over time. And here's what we have today in the after the rebuilding of the museum, which incorporated some historic parts of the original building. One of the more recent reopenings was the Murphy Windmill in out near the beach, which was in complete disrepair. The windmill was built in the early 1900s, and due to its exposure to the ocean, it over time it just totally disintegrated. And but luckily, it has been completely rebuilt and refaced, and an entire copper dome rebuilt. I might add that both of the windmills in Golden Gate Park have a unique device, and that is, you'll notice in this photo on the top a round finned fan element. And that is in order to help align the windmill automatically with the incoming wind. In the old days, windmills needed to be actually positioned by hand. You've seen probably pictures of a windmill in Holland where workers had to actually rotate the windmill. But this was a newly invented device that was used on both the windmills in Golden Gate Park. So various other improvements that happened over time is new signage is slowly but surely going in to all of the main entry areas. The Shakespeare Garden, this is a photo that was taken probably in the 60s, and it showed where there is in the center position a bronze bust of Will Shakespeare. It indeed was covered over for a good amount of its time in Golden Gate Park due to potential vandalism. And thankfully that has at this point been undone. And here was a rare moment in the 1990s when in fact that case was opened up. It had a steel shutters plus a glass window pane in front of it. Well, none of that exists anymore. The wall in which this occurs has been completely restored. Three of the panels flanking that have engraved works of Shakespeare that had been stolen have been replaced at this point. The wall cleaned up, and it's a much nicer presentation at this point. So there have been some various discoveries in Golden Gate Park. Here's a picture, an aerial picture of the soccer fields out near the beach, circa the 1940s, that have certainly been redone since and all that. But I found an interesting anomaly that this was a gun emplacement area during the Cold War, the period of 1952 to 1959. This was an anti-aircraft facility. It worked well. No one knew about it because it was shielded by all the greenery. And if you were a casual visitor in Golden Gate Park, even in the nearby golf course, you had no idea that this thing was there. And so this anti-aircraft facility was a pre-Nike installation. Before the Nike missiles were built and placed around town, there were several of these much smaller gun emplacements that in this case were placed in the soccer fields. But in 1959, that was all taken away. This shows a drawing that I found in the archive at the GGNRA that shows this was a village of men who were living here to take care of the guns. They had their own living quarters, mess quarters. They ate and lived there. and where it, the area was surrounded by a fence. So that's gone at this point, of course. Several people have talked about the zoo in Golden Gate Park over time. And so I sought to identify, well, you know, what do you mean by zoo? I think of zoo as a collection of animals that are all in one area. But in fact, when you really go through and look at the animals that were in Golden Gate Park from the 1890s until the 1920s, that in fact they were clustered in three areas. Each area had more than one collection of animals. And so here's one entry, the very first aviary, really the beginning of 1890 was the first year that various animals were brought into the park. So this was a pheasantry that was located not far from the Conservatory of Flowers today, a beautiful little Victorian construction that had a house in the center and then various cages that went out in this four square pattern. We've all seen the Doughboy statue in Redwood Memorial Grove. It's been a staple there since the 1930s. But this has an interesting backstory. The statue itself, which was sculpted by M. Earl Cummings, who was, by the way, a park commissioner. And it was he who sculpted the piece as well as many others that are in Golden Gate Park. Well, the backstory on this is that he had done a piece called Vigor, which is identical to the Doughboy, but it had a different meaning, and also that he was in classically nude and used at the Panama Pacific International Exposition in 1915. A series of these statues were cast of Cummings' first initial piece that is the lead up to the Doughboy as we see them today. Some things have been found that were thought to be lost, didn't know where they were. This is a horse fountain that was at one point in the Birkut equitation field. And the piece originally had come from the beach. It was sculpted by, again, M. Earl Cummings. It's a horse drinking fountain. And eventually it was moved after work was done at the beach on the sewage plant in the 1970s and 80s. It was brought into Birkut Field, was there for a few years, but then vandals tried to haul it away by hooking it up to the back of a car. And the only information I had in doing the research on it was the fact that Herb Cain had mentioned it in his column and said that the piece had been wrecked. And I found no trace of that after that point. But in fact, it had just been put in a warehouse. And after I did a story that was published in the Western Neighborhoods Project Journal a few years ago, someone noticed, oh yeah, I know where that thing is. And so it was pulled out of storage. And in fact, it wasn't in that bad a condition. And the Golden Gate Park structural staff were able to actually do work on it and restore the piece. And it's now right at the back of McLaren Lodge. It was installed in 2019, is now a decorative fountain. And so the piece lives on, even though it's been in storage for many years. Another piece that was actually in storage, and I thought totally lost, was a statue that was part of the Brion Gate. Now, so that's at 19th Avenue and Lincoln Way, where we have Highway 1 that goes today through the park. Well, when this gate was originally created, Golden Gate, the highway did not yet go through the park. And so the road configuration went around a column and a statue that you see here. And so when in the early 1940s, the highway did go through the park, the column and statue were removed, and I could find no trace of either until relatively recently. So here's the you see today, if you're out in the site of that with the highway going through. Well, after the horse fountain find, I thought I should go searching in various warehouses that Recreation and Park has in the park. And sure enough, I found this thing, which no one had any idea what it was. And it turned out to be the very statue that had sat on top of that column. It had been removed in 1938, put in the warehouse, and has never seen the light of day apparently since, because there's been no reports on it whatsoever. So at least it's known where it was. I have tried to figure out who actually designed it without any luck so far, but we know who the architect of the actual gate was and all of that, but some more research over time may reveal that, hopefully. There's an element in Golden Gate Park called the Ghirardelli Card Shelter, of which it today has risen anew in an area near the Conservatory of Flowers, but it was once located in its original incarnation just off of Stanion and Haight Streets, shown here in this map, right next to Alboard Lake. And what it was amusingly called the Old Men's Playground. It's an area that had been developed for board games, card games, and things like that, and was very popular in the early half of the 1900s. Even John McLaren would hang out there on Sundays sometimes. Well, in the 1930s, during the depths of the Great Depression, Domingo Ghirardelli had died, and his wife, Addie Ghirardelli, gave money in order to have a shelter next to this area created, and so people could get out of the sun or just have a little enclosure, or if it was in the wintertime, for example. And that unfortunately fell into disrepair over time, and in the 1970s was taken apart. But what you see today is the picture shown here, which is the newer incarnation built in 1988. Now, what that contains are the remnants on the bases of the columns of the original shelter. And those were these beautiful elements of gigantic bronze chess pieces. Rooks and knights and things of that nature. And here's some details of on the right-hand center and right-hand side showing some of those bases. What you'll never see probably again is the thing that's on the left-hand photo, and that is the plaque that was part on the back wall of the shelter as given by Mrs. Ghirardelli, and it shows a bas relief of Domingo Ghirardelli. The story on this is that it was stolen in 1988 when the original shelter was demolished and surfaced in the year 2000, many years later, in a metal scrapyard. I had been in touch with the Ghirardelli family about the history of this anyway, but they called me and asked me to go over and take a look at the piece in the scrapyard, and I did. Negotiations fell through in order to reacquire it, and the piece disappeared again. And so luckily I took some photos, but we may never see that piece again. So coming to the future of Golden Gate Park, there are some big issues that are happening over time. Here's a picture of all of the statues that were piled off to the side when the music concourse was being rebuilt. And of course, a lot has happened in the way of statues in the past just few months, looking at the lack of women being represented, specific women, as opposed to just people represented specifically and not just allegorical women. And then just to the issue of statues, period. But the bigger thing for Golden Gate Park is then the traffic. And are these streets really meant for cars or are they meant for people? And certainly during this time of the pandemic, we are having a great experiment by having JFK Drive, the main drive, closed to all vehicles, and the people get to take over, just as you see here. What used to be just the weekend is now every day of the week and will continue for a while. And here's what it normally looks like on a Sunday with museums in full swing and all that. So here's the book. The book has all new photographs from the original publication, more photographs. There's 25% more content. It's a larger format. Right now it's available in soft cover, but we hope to bring it out in a hardcover format at some time soon. And this shows you the table of contents pages, which give the overall view of what's in the book. The map above is laid out in six sections that we start on towards the downtown on the eastern end and work our way westward to the Music Concourse, Stowe Lake, west of Crossover Drive, the stadium or polo fields, and then out to the ocean. So here's an example of one of the opening chapters of the book, which always has a historic photograph, large historic photograph. And in this case, I think it's really interesting because the photograph shows in the foreground the Sharon Building. This is probably photographed around the turn of the century. And in the middle ground is the Francis Scott Key Monument, which we know has been, somewhat dismantled recently. And then in the background is the Conservatory of Flowers. Those things were in alignment originally. And I'm going to talk about really the Francis Scott Key Monument. We knew where it was, but in fact, not until last year, when the tennis center was starting to be reconstructed, that they were digging around in one of the tennis courts and found this big foundation. And I was called in to try and tell them what it was. And sure enough, it was the foundation to the Key Monument, that even though the monument had been moved to other places on more than one occasion, that in fact, they left the foundation underneath the tennis court. And here's a typical view of the pages with the kinds of photographs, new photographs, and how each element in the park, there's some 156 elements, whether it be a building, a meadow, a bench in some cases, a lake, there's a history, a complete history as much as I know right now. Using in some cases, color postcards, like on the upper right, to show, illustrate what things look like. In this case, this page is showing some of the focused articles. I talked about the zoo a little while ago and how that all played out. So this map photo shows a separate map that has been inserted in the back, and you can take that out and look in great detail as to where the things are located when you're to be brought on site with you. So that gives you an overview of the book and some of the contents in it. And if you're interested in potentially buying the book, which is $45 plus shipping, you can contact Norfolk Press at norfolkpress.com. And you'll be able to click through being able to purchase a book through that website. So thank you so much. And I'll see you soon.
All right. We do have a question and a couple questions and comment here. So first we'll start, we had a question that came in over email earlier. And the question, Christopher, is, following the 1906 earthquake, many SF residents camped in Golden Gate Park. Where was the tent city or cities located? How were the tents provided? And how long was the tent city in place? Any light you can shed on those questions?
Yeah, there were several areas in the park. One of them clustered around the McLaren Lodge area and the emergency hospital, Park Emergency, which is next to Alvord Lake in that area. Ironically, Park Emergency had collapsed. So as even though they had hospital facilities, it was of no use to. And so in the bigger picture, the Army had to come in. But let me finish answering the question about, there were also, facilities out in Speedway Meadows, as well as in Big Rec as well. And all of this was overseen by the government. General Funston out of the Presidio was in charge of the entire city, which is why his name has been known for many years. And it was he who was in charge of putting this all together. So all these, it was a variety of facilities. In the beginning, it was just people, you know, putting up these little tents made out of sometimes rugs and things like that. But as it got more organized, barracks were built. And there were no earthquake shacks as we call them today. There were in fact just barracks, and then combined with tents, usually these large, what are known as Sibley tents. They could sleep an entire family, probably 6 or 8 people could be in one of these tents. And so each area, there were a combination of those things. And all of this lasted until 1907, when it was clear that people were able to fend for themselves a little more. So John McLaren, the superintendent of the time, was certainly anxious to have all of those folks out of his park so he could get into restoration efforts. So hopefully that gives a little background on that.
Great. We have another one. A question about Alvord Lake Cottage, and wondering if you had any a description or details about that in the book, or anything you could share with us now.
I'm not sure what is being asked here. So there was some sort of building at Alvord Lake. I have no idea what it is. I've tried to trace it. It was just south of the lake. There was some sort of small cottage. It must have been somebody who lived in the park. And by the way, in the early days, a lot of the people who worked there actually lived in the park because it was out in the middle of nowhere. There were no residences nearby. So it was not uncommon. And that was why John McLaren lived at McLaren Lodge. They were all living within the park. As to who the person was or why, I do not know. That's a mystery to me, yet to be resolved.
Sounds like a fun new task and something to include in the next edition.
Definitely.
there's another question about what was the purpose of the panhandle portion in the design of the park?
My understanding is that was really a political maneuver over the shaping of Golden Gate Park. It was generally thought that the land in that area was probably closest to the city was going to be too valuable eventually. And So those who put together the layout of the park decided to skinny that area down, creating this panhandle shape. And then the trade-off was the acquisition or taking of what we know as Buena Vista Park today. The map that I showed early on in this presentation showed that as it was actually part of Order 800 of Buena Vista Park as part of the deal. Most people don't know that. Usually think it's just the park, but it's, there's more than that. And so that's how that apparently got shaped.
Wonderful. Here's a fun question, and maybe impossible for a historian to answer. What's your favorite historical structure in the park?
Oh yeah, that's really hard. you know, I love them all, I guess. You know, the Conservatory of Flowers, I guess, just because I love gardening and horticulture and all of that, and it is an exquisite piece, especially in its restored version. It's quite a piece of technology, actually, for its time. I think that's partly why, and that it's so decorative as well as being functional all at the same time. Yeah.
Great. Here's a very informed question. In 1983, John Rock shipped by rail car two carloads of palms to Golden Gate Park. Was there a railroad leading to the park at that time? And the second part of the question is, they were planted along the avenue leading from the lake to the aviary. Is that the building that you showed earlier?
I have no idea. I don't know on that. I haven't tracked that particular, obviously well-informed piece of information. I couldn't comment on that. Sorry.
It's great to know that there are unanswered questions still to be discovered. Someone asked about the locations of monastery stones, and I know we have many in the botanical garden, but are there other locations of monastery stones throughout Golden Gate Park?
There are many locations. They are scattered all over the place. William Randolph Hearst's legacy, some say specifically Raymond Clary commented that Hearst foisted the stones on Golden Gate Park as part of a deal to get rid of inventory because he was suddenly becoming low in funds, if that's possible to think. But so Stowe Lake has tons of them around the perimeter. You'll find them. You will probably, in virtually every garden in Golden Gate Park, find a few. And once you get to know the lay of the land about what they look like and see a lot of them, you'll recognize them. They're definitely, there's some around McLaren Lodge. You can find them pretty much scattered anywhere because they were, I'll say, free for the taking within the park and during the years after the crates had burned that they were once in, and they were just there until what was left of the stones were taken away and rebuilt as a wonderful part of a monastery in Vina, Upper Vina, California, which I went to see a few years ago. And it is a wonderful creation that's up there now.
Great. Another question is there a freshwater aquifer near the ocean and the windmills that pumped water into the park to water the trees and plants?
I finally did some specific research on that and found, in fact, where the chain of lakes today, that was in the 1890s. The reason they were put there was, in fact, at the time, there was water bubbling out of the ground. And it's documented in newspapers. I wouldn't trust hearsay. I had to see it for myself, but there was a full description of what was going on and where it was located from the 1890s when the chain of lakes was being developed. And so that was the beginning of some of the thoughts about that maybe there was water, fresh water available near the ocean. Yeah.
Great. Another question is about, you know, just because of the age of Golden Gate Park and its tree canopy, a question is it true that there are trees in Golden Gate Park that are in decline at this point?
Absolutely. You know, some of the trees were planted in beginning in the 1870s. It's probably a good fact that some of those are still there today. I garden in the fuchsia dell, for example, and it's clear that some of those trees have been there a really long time. And of course, they were planted at various times over the time of William Hammond Hall in the beginning, the designer of the park, and then followed by John McLaren. And yes, their trees have a life just as people do. And over time, in the 1980s, there was recognition of the fact that we need to do something about this, and reports were put out, and those have been followed over time. I don't think it's probably been as aggressively dealt with as it probably could have, or should have, I should say. But it's a thing that has, it turns out in talking to the head arborist, Kelly Cornell, it's kind of difficult to do. You can't just take down large trees selectively. You actually have to, because of the danger and such, you have to actually take entire areas out, which is what you're beginning, you've seen over time, that you'll see a cluster of area that will be completely, the old trees will be taken out and then replanted. You see the same thing in the Presidio as well, that technique, because of the limitations of how you can replant.
Thanks. I know that as part of the Golden Gate Park 150th celebration, there was a huge planting effort, and there are restoration efforts that have been in progress for many years. One commenter specifically mentions the coast live oak woodland behind the Conservatory of Flowers and noted that it was recently added to the National Registry of what remains of our country's native woodlands. And that was largely a volunteer and rec and park effort. It was a nice comment about the love of that space and restoration work to include native plants. So wonderful, wonderful comment. And knowing that part of what makes the park wonderful is its canopy, and knowing that we need to keep on working on that in order for it to be as beautiful in the generations to come.
Absolutely.
Another question here, we'll maybe do like two or three more, and if we don't cover all of them, then we will come back to you over email. But I have one question about the history of the lake and waterfall across the street from Speedway Meadow, now known as Hellman Hollow.
So I would assume that we're talking about Lloyd Lake and the water cataracts that fall into that. So the waterfall from where the water starts for that whole thing is Rainbow Falls, that was in the 1920s, just a dump, literally a dump area that people were complaining about. We want this beautified, cleaned up and all that. And Herbert Fleischacker, who was the president of the park commission at the time, made sure that that happened. And the falls are called Rainbow Falls because they were illuminated by lights that are actually still embedded, but they're not working anymore in the artificial waterfall that comes down from the top of the cliff. And then, so that falls into a small lake, and then it goes in cataracts down under a roadway, and then tumbles eventually into Lloyd Lake. And I might point out at the intersection of Crossover Drive and Main Drive, where the water goes under the roadway, after it exits, if you're walking along, you will see the most bizarre optical illusion. The water appears to be flowing uphill. And it's just a circumstance of the roadway going down, and stand there, you'll see what I mean. Anyway, after the water it's gone then down into Lloyd Lake, which is named after Reuben Lloyd, who was a park commissioner as well. And so that was, many of these bodies of water had to do with being essentially reservoirs for irrigation. And this was no different. And of course, we have the portals of the past that were a memory of the Knob Hill Mansion, the town mansion that stood on Knob Hill until the fire of 1906. And it was taken out except for the entry portal, which was eventually moved to Lloyd Lake in 1909. That was put there. So that's a little background on that area.
Great. Someone's asking about, and I have fond memories of this from visiting the original Academy of Science building. What happened to the dolphin statue that was at the old Academy of Science building? And then this person also sends a little wish that it could replace the Francis Scott Key statue.
Yeah, well, it's actually called the whales. A lot of people mistake it for dolphins, but they're really much larger when you look at them. So that statue, which was originally at the Golden Gate International Exhibition on Treasure Island in the 1939-40, was then moved to eventually to the park, and only part of it, in fact, only the center portion of it was a lot bigger and had a base, and I found pictures of it that kind of inform what it used to look like. And when the Academy was demolished, that went into storage. It's actually out at City College at this point. And it's in pieces. People kind of check in on it regularly, and stories come up on the in the newspapers about it and the internet. It doesn't have a home at this point. It's just kind of sitting there. The idea, I think, was that City College has many artworks around its campus, and that it should be hopefully resurrected there at some point. So hopefully that can happen. You know, who knows? It's in the future, but we know where it is. So yeah.
One participant notes, the new Ferris wheel as part of kind of the park's evolution. What other enhancements to Golden Gate Park have come and gone over the years?
Oh, well, the Ferris wheel that we see today is just a very temporary kind of thing. It was just for the celebration of 150th But I would say the biggest thing is really the predecessor to that, what was known as the Firth Wheel, that was part of the 1894 Midwinter Fair. And it was that fair which really impacted and created the basis for the music concourse that we see today. It was decided, Michael O'Shaughnessy, who was the city engineer at the time in 1894, designed the music concourse and created the oval shape that we see today, which was surrounded by a variety of exhibition buildings. And one of those remained, and that was the beginning of the Young Museum that we know today. But the Egyptian style building that was part of the fair was the very beginning. And so I would say that the 1894 fair was the thing that really had the most impact on the development of Golden Gate Park and left us really, I think, with a wonderful legacy of at least the Young and the form of the music concourse, which is virtually as it was when it was built in 1894. Yeah.
All right, we're gonna do, let's see, one more question and then we'll wrap up. This one is a fun specific one and I'm really curious too. On the concourse, music concourse fountain, there is a tiger and serpent. Do you have any details about that? Why and what that's about?
So that piece was sculpted by M. Earl Cummings. I wish I could have gotten into his mind because I have no clue. I have tried to think that thing through and do research on it too. And I cannot come up with anything other than he was really good at doing animals in motion. As many were at that time. He was part of a movement of usually in bronze. In this case, it's actually a cast concrete. And so the movement of animals, but I don't know to answer the question. It's one of those things that's not yet been revealed to me in my research. So, yeah.
Well, the last question will be there. The commenter kind of wishes that they could use this book digitally while visiting the park. Do you foresee ever having a digital version of the book?
It's possible. You know, we've certainly talked about it due to COVID right now and the economic situation. We've really kind of put that and the hardcover on hold for the time being, but I certainly would hope that there's that possibility. Yeah.
Great. Well, Christopher, it's been so wonderful to have you with us tonight. Thank you so much for sharing. Your enthusiasm for the park is infectious, and I hope that everybody is curious to learn more. You had mentioned that your book is available to purchase in person at the Golden Gate Park 150 Welcome Center, which is located across from the Conservatory of Flowers. Is that correct?
That's true, yes. Yes. So that's a place where you can actually go and buy the book as opposed to the online, which I was discussing earlier.
Great. Well, with that, I just want to thank you again. I'll go ahead and share out that URL for the Norfolk Press, where anybody who wants to buy the book online can do that there, and also the link to the library's virtual exhibit celebrating the canopy trees of Golden Gate Park. Christopher, thank you very much. It was wonderful spending time with you, and be well, everybody.
Thank you, Jessa. Good night.